Welcome to Guitar Paradiso on Andertons TV. My name is Pete.
My name is Mick, and welcome.
Yeah, and it's warm.
It's warm.
It's warm.
Yeah, so for those of you watching in the future, this was the hottest day of the year in 2016.
Oh, was that yesterday?
16. Might have been yesterday, but it feels like it could be today.
But this is still early.
But this is good, because, you know, it's paradise.
We just need the shorts and the flip-flops, man.
Yeah, not really a short guy, to be honest, but there we are.
Are you not? You've got lovely legs. You're welcome. Yeah. Right, so today we are looking at Reverend guitars, new at Andertons. They're absolutely fantastic.
Yes.
I mean, just look at this. Well, you know the story about it.
Well, there's a short story to tell. So Joe Naylor.
Yes.
Joe Naylor is a guy.
Is a guy.
And Joe studied all kinds of design and stuff when he was younger. He also studied luthiery, so he studied guitar making. He set up a guitar shop, which sold vintage and used gear, but also became like an amp repair shop. And off the back of that, he launched Naylor Amps.
Yep.
Joe Naylor, Naylor Amps.
Yeah.
Of which he sold out to his business partner.
Okay.
Eventually. And then started the Reverend Guitar Company in 1997. So that's the potted history.
Yeah.
And I guess Joe's thing is that he's all about the design, all about the detail, all about just making sure that everything exactly as it should be.
Yeah.
And the whole point of Reverend Guitars really was, don't be the same.
Exactly.
So it stands. It says on the back here, spoiler alert, you'll never stand out if you're trying to fit in, which is kind of a nice.
And it says, Reverend, well played.
It's true,
I
Pete.
Think some of them have got different. The only way you'd have more attitude is if, what does that say?
You'd grown another middle finger. Nice, okay. So we're getting a sense of the whole ethos behind Reverend.
Yeah.
You know, not the same, be a little bit different. And how welcome is that in today's market?
Oh, it's absolutely fantastic, you know, because we are looking at guitars that always look kind of the same. It's kind
not
of
everyone
setup,
wants a Fender,
you know,
or a Gibson.
Exactly. Not everybody wants to have, you know, three single coils or whatever. And and you know what I really like about these guitars is this little thing here. We'll come to that later, that little bass roll-off. I think that's a fantastic, cool feature. But the guitars just look, the shape is like nothing you've ever seen before. And that's really what caught my eye when they came into the shop.
But it's clearly rooted in a kind of traditional retro world.
Yes.
You know, and they're on. I mean, they talk about a lot of this in some of their videos, but in the early days, Dan Electro was an influence.
Yes. You've seen my old one, you know, yeah.
Yeah, with like sandpaper is a bit of a gag they go on about. Anyway, watch the videos on the Reverend website. But clearly there are little bits of design borrowed from here, there and everywhere to make this pretty individual hole.
Yeah. And they make loads of different models, so you know I'm sure there'll be something for everyone in there. They're making bolt-on necks. They make
there's a signature series, a bolt-on series, and a set neck series.
Set neck series.
There may be others, but those are the main
bases.
Three. Oh yeah, bases.
There's bases, which there is a video on the Andertons channel. The link will be below. You can go and have a look at that. And there's also left-hand versions of a lot of the guitars, which a lot of you ask. I know that none of us are left-handed, and but there are. They do a lot of them left-handed, and on the website you can click in there and you can see all the different versions and the different colors and, you know, with the pickups. And so how they make these guitars is that they basically design them. Well,
yeah, they're made in Korea.
Yeah, made in Korea.
And that links through to the really key bit.
Yeah.
We're talking very mid-price.
Yeah.
So
actually, we were quite...
Yeah, I was surprised. So I hadn't really seen very many Reverend guitars before. Going to the store this morning to pick them out. And we've seen guitars that kind of have this sort of vibe in the boutique arena. Mm-hmm. And it wouldn't, you know, I've seen guitars that look a little bit like this that you'd see like 2K plus on.
Yeah.
For in English pounds and probably in dollars as well.
Yeah.
But we're talking like, what, mid 500s?
We're talking 599, I think some of these are, but I'm not quite sure. Of course, again, we links are below for the pricing.
Yeah. So we're talking hundreds of pounds rather than thousands.
Yeah.
So, back to that point. They're made in Korea. The main bulk of the kind of manufacturing and everything is done there. They're then shipped to the States, where all the setup and final assembly, or at least setup and making them ready for to go out.
Exactly, and then they go straight from Reverend Guitars to the shop. So, there's no middleman in a way. So in that way, it means that the guitars are more affordable to you. The end.
Yeah, the traditional distribution step is taken out, which of course takes out a huge chunk of margin.
Exactly. So, I can imagine that means they can put like Wilkinson on there, and they can use really good components and stuff.
Yeah.
And you know, they've set up really nicely. You've got locking tuners on the back here.
Yeah, they're called Pin, I think. Reverend Pin. Hang on, I've got it written down somewhere. Pinlock tuners.
Pinlock tuners, yeah.
So it's a bit like the old Spurzel design where you've got this wheel here. There's a pin in the middle which...
Put the string in.
Yeah.
Turn it on, the pin goes in, holds the string in there.
And they're staggered height too, so you don't need a second, you don't need two string trees.
Yeah, it's great. And I like this little bit here that actually somebody's written, see if you can see that, written with a little pen, serial number. And whoever's set it up, I don't know, but that's really cool. It gives it a little bit of a personal kind of design, you know, a little personal touch. And so I've got here, I've got the double agent. And I'm not quite sure which is their most popular version, because there were so many of them and they're new to us now, you know.
Yeah, so I mean, body shape wise, I mean that's broadly an offset double cut, broadly.
It's kind of this. It's almost like cartoonish.
Yeah.
I like this bit here. It's kind of
a bit Jetsons.
Bit sort of hey.
Yeah.
It's got a bit long, but I like it.
Well, let's start there then. So double agent, solid Carina body.
Yeah.
Which is kind of unusual because you might expect. Older Agathis, maple, basswood, you know, whatever. In a mid-price guitar, so Carina's a nice spec point there.
Yeah.
What we got? We got a Special H pickup in the bridge, and we've got a Wilkinson WVS50 2K vibrato there.
Yeah.
And that is
P90.
Yes. So CP90 ceramic magnet.
Yeah. Is that their own P90. Designs, these ones here?
Yeah, they design all the pickups themselves, design and spec all the pickups themselves. So.
Yeah, and they sound good. You've got a three-way switch where you switch between neck, middle, both, and then the back. You've got a volume, tone, then...
Let's start there, shall we, Pete?
Yes, this is the one. So, this is like a bass roll-off switch, isn't it?
It's completely passive, no batteries or anything, it's just a bass roll-off.
Right, so here... Your favorite chord in the entire world, G. I'm going into the Fender Hot Rod Deluxe. So, bass roll off, all the way off. Mm-hmm. That's very cool, isn't it?
It's really cool. You might, with a straight, clean guitar sound, you probably listen to that and go, why on earth would you want to, because it sounds lovely and big and fat with the, with, here we go, I'll do it on this one.
Yeah.
So this is the Charger 290.
Yeah.
Charger 290.
Yeah.
So,
anyway. I like that. That's like the car, isn't it? Hello.
That was the tone pop.
Because it's up there, isn't it? Look,
yeah,
it's
go,
up there.
Go. And as we said, with a clean tone, you know, it sounds big and fat and huge with it in.
Yeah.
But I think where it would become really useful is if you were in a band situation, you had a lot of overdrive on, and you just needed to get a little more clarity or get out of that mix a little bit.
Yeah.
It would also stop your amp overdriving so much, because so much of that power goes into the bass bit, and that's where it starts really overdriving the power section. And I can just see, I'm forever telling people, you know, when you go for a solo boost, turn the bass down a bit, because you'll ping out in the mix a little bit more.
Yeah.
That is going to be super useful for that, just on the fly. So you don't need to worry about your pedals and your amp. You can just knock a little bit back.
I'm going to be controversial and say, or you can use it and push it in when you get the solo.
Yeah.
Let's say you're playing something like this, you know, with it rolled off. You just want to go clean tone, but nothing else.
Definitely with clean sounds.
You
yeah.
See what I mean? With a clean, so if you've got a clean tone, you just want to...
Because it's putting a bit of a kind of lower mids back in there as well. It's
exactly.
Not just bass.
Yeah. Clever.
Good, I like that.
Like it.
And most of the guitars have got that.
Yeah.
Certainly, I think all of these
will find out. Yeah.
So that's the kind of... That's one of the USBs. The other thing I just noticed about this, which I really like, is the... on most bolt-on necks, bolt neck guitars, you get like flat, straight, the neck would be parallel with the body and it would go straight. But this is actually pitched back a little bit, which gives you a few cool things. One, it enables the tunematic bridge there to sit up high. And two, you get a little bit more back over the nut a bit, a little bit more string tension over the nut. It's cool. Feels nice. Feels kind of, because it's pitched back a bit, it just gives you a little bit of in-betweeny Gibson and Fender traditional feel.
Absolutely.
It's really
Absolutely.
Cool. Actually.
Great guitars.
Yeah. Let's have a listen to that humbucker, shall we?
Okay, so the humbucker in the back, pick up, I roll the tone, the bass boost. Oh. I really, really like it.
Get some overdrive on. Okay. Get some overdrive.
Gristle King. Anyway,
really
doesn't that
cool.
sound good?
It's got character. Now, danger of a generalisation here, but play a lot of mid-price guitars, you know, when they're overly thick finished and all of that, maybe slightly overly heavy bodies and stuff. And one thing, in my opinion, those guitars are missing compared to higher-end guitars is character.
Yeah.
Character all day long.
If you want something that's got a really cool look and a really cool sound and usability and, you know, rosewood fingerboard, I like that these are kind of... What is that? Is that like a bone or something?
No. It'll be like a coloured...
Yeah.
It's to...
it's got a little bit of line in there. I like it.
It's to mimic the old clay dots that
you would
find on old Fenders. But
I really, really, really like this. Again, this is going to happen again, isn't it? Why, every time I do a video, I'm going to end up wanting these guitars? I'm going to have a separate room for the guitars. No, you're not having it.
Taylor's saying, no, I'm having that
one. I love this one. I'm going to have that one.
Yeah.
See, I want, guys, if you can do, Joe, if you can do this in an orange, I'll have it. what is the lacquer on them?
There was a special edition for a US retailer in quite a cool green. So you want the equivalent orange. maybe there's a conversation to be had there.
Yeah, maybe we should have a little conversation about that. Like the racing, you know, like the General Lee car, orange in this.
Yeah, that would work.
You know what I'm saying?
You'd like that.
I like that. I would love it.
You know what I'm saying?
Anyway.
Right. So, P90s. Reverend's P90s, at least the CP90, which is what these are, bridge and neck.
Yep.
Using a ceramic magnet.
Okay.
You might think of a vintage pickup as being more associated with an Alnico magnet, but these are ceramic. This one is wound to be, so say, a little bit hotter than a traditional vintage P90.
Yeah.
This one to be a little less hot.
Okay.
So you get more clarity. Anyway, whatever that may be, here we go. So here's a bridge pickup into the Victory V22. Mm-hmm. With some overdrive.
Yeah, that's the Nobles ODR1, by the way, he's got on the floor there.
That's so cool, because obviously the difference between the bridge and the neck in terms of high M response is wide, as you would expect.
Yeah.
So just having that option to be able to just roll some of that bass off without, you know, if you roll the top off on the treble pickup, it's a different thing.
Yeah. So what is the scale length of these? Are they the same?
Bolts are 25.5.
Okay.
So same as Fender scale length.
Yeah.
And this guitar that will come up onto in a sec, set neck is 24.75.
We should really change over, shouldn't we? Because we talked a lot about these.
Let's do that.
We just ramble on.
Right, so different guitars, just going to pick up from where we were.
It's green.
Bigsby wobble there, just to completely mask the slightly out of tune. So this is the Tricky Gomez 290. Reverend has a guitar called the Manta Ray, on which it's based.
Yeah.
Which is this kind of slightly semi-hollow, sharp cut. Sort of reminds me a little bit of an old Gibson Barney Kessel or a...
What was that Robin Ford one? They had the Fender Robin Ford thing.
Vox guitars had a kind of sharp cut guitar like this. Yeah. Poke
somebody's eye out with that.
Yeah, pretty cool. Pretty cool kind of retro, deliberately retro.
And I like that they've coloured the neck at the neck in the same colour as the whole thing.
I mean, you might say it's a bit of a Trini Lopez kind of feel to the whole thing.
What's his name?
Dave Grohl. Yeah. Okay. And as you can see, it's got a Bigsby B70 vibrato, which is very nice, top mount one there, which sounds, I'll put some delay on, you know, because you should for this kind of thing. We'll go to the middle position. Bigsby Fair. If you treat it nice, it'll
be nice to you.
It'll be nice to you. Yeah.
It's lovely. So, rosewood fingerboard on that one, I assume.
Yes.
P90s.
Yes. And a 24.75-inch scale length on this as well. Yeah. Given its more sort of roughly Gibson leanings.
And I've got the what is that? Buckshot.
That is the Buckshot.
It's the Buckshot.
Back to the bolt-on range.
Back to the bolt-on range. As you can see here in the back, you've got this is really cool up here. It's got the old sort of Les Paul style.
Tunematic, yeah, because again, the neck is pitched back on that, which for Fender fans among you is going to feel slightly different from your average bolt-on neck.
Yeah, style. Sort of feels like you can attack it a bit more, you know what I mean, kind of Bosch. You've got your standard three-way switch, volume and tone, and then you got your bass up here like you had on yours before.
Right, pickups. Right, pickup they are, wise. So that is called a Revtron neck.
Revtron.
Right. So it's inspired by a Gretsch Filter Tron style pickup.
Yeah.
But it's a little bit hotter apparently.
Yeah.
And it's an Alnico magnet, and it's also positioned a little bit further back from the end of the fingerboard.
Yeah.
So say Reverend, to just balance out a little bit with the bridge pickup, which is ceramic magnet, Tele style pickup.
Yeah.
But again, wound to be a little bit hotter than you would imagine from, or at least constructed to be a little bit hotter than you would imagine from that kind of pickup.
Let's hear it. That was the let me roll. Sorry, go on.
It's got that it's got that definite sort of clarity and chime that you would expect. It's like a Memphis guitar, isn't it?
It is like, I'll just roll up bass off again and do the same thing. I do like that bass thing.
That is so interesting, that bass control, because it's not just putting bass in, it's also giving you quite a considerable extra amount of level.
It pushes the level up on this pickup anyway, you know.
Yeah, and then just for sitting back rhythm, you know, if you were playing that exact kind of part in a band where you've got bass, drums, maybe horns, you know, all kinds of things.
Yeah.
Just knocking that bass back a bit is just going to help you sit, still be heard, guitar part's still going to come through, but you're not going to be adding to all that bass that's coming from the whole band.
I mean, it's lovely. Let's just go put on these two here. So I'll do the same because there's a nice groove.
Yes, I'm sorry for playing with Pete's knob during the
Oh, you do there. Actually do that again while I play the same thing.
No, because it was you were playing on the neck pickup, and I was so desperate to hear the in between sound, I had to fiddle. So
just do the middle, the two together. Honky there.
We're going to have to get some gain on that in a minute. So, as we said, ceramic magnet picker.
Wow.
Lots and lots of... Okay, so I want to hear that through here. The reason I suggested that is because this is putting a huge amount of upper mid into that amp. So I want to see if it does the same thing.
Yeah.
So we'll do the same thing, put on some gain.
That's a copper.
Yeah, okay, so... too much compression.
I don't like this guitar as well. Good. That is very, very good.
Interesting.
There's the interesting again.
I was just going to explain what happened there. So because that Alnico pickup, ceramic pickup, was putting out so much oomph into Pete's amp there, I just really wanted to hear it through I can't call it V22.
There you go.
The Sheriff 22. Victory Sheriff 22, which is obviously is a more Marshall style amp. And you heard a combination of clean into the amp, you heard the Nobles ODR1 overdrive, and you also heard, when I leant back, turned the master volume down and the gain up, just the amp itself.
Yeah.
And that pickup holds onto loads of character, gives clarity so you can hear all the notes, and then again, rolling down that bass thing just to give you a bit more definition.
Wow. Good That's pickups, boys, cool. man. Good That's, pickups.
Well, just a good combination of things that kind of work really well there.
And it's a guitar you can use for lots of different things as well. It's not well, just I think you
were playing the funky stuff there.
And that was great, and now you just rocked out on it as well.
Yeah, what a versatile guitar.
My goodness me.
Well, anyway,
I think we just need to play a little bit.
Yeah.
And then and let people go the links below for their perusal. Peruse the links below.
Would you like this one back?
No. Do you like that? You have that? I'll play a little bit on this. Maybe we'll swap over and, you know, maybe cut some stuff in here and there, you know, it's nice. And then, you know, play a bit and swap over some guitars a little. It's all good, man. It's all good. Anyway, that was the Reverend guitars. Of course, there's loads of them. There's loads of models. But go and have a look on the website or on Anderson's website.
Buckshot.
Tricky Gomez.
Tricky Gomez 290.
Yeah. Double Agent. And a Taylor. There you go.
And a Charger 290.
And a Charger 290. Awesome guitars. There is more, and I'm sure we'll be using them. I really like them. Again, another video that's going to cost me money.
They call that an occupational hazard.
Is that what it is? Is that what it is? People sort of work and they sort of break their legs or get heavy things on their feet. I just end up spending money. Yeah, it's awful. Anyway, this was Guitar Paradiso of Roman Guitars on Andertons TV, and I'm Pete.
And I'm Mick.
And we'll see you next time. Catch those seagulls.
Sorry, obviously I knew you were going to fade long before then.